praise God for that answer prayer. So that's what we're going to, we're going to actually study today on a topic that the Lord has impressed in my heart. And maybe many of you have been dealing with this issue, which is on fear and on protection. When we ask the Lord to protect us, many times we ask Him, protect me, Lord, help me, Lord. But we make it a request like, okay, maybe, if you know, if you got time, God, please protect me, please help me. And many believers, unfortunately, have been living and accepting the lies of the enemy and have been living in fear. So tonight, I'm going to first pray, and then after we pray, we're going to open our Bibles to Psalm 91, a beautiful psalm, a beautiful promise that God has given each and every one of us of His protection. But let's just close our eyes in prayer. Father, I just thank You. I worship You, Lord. I thank You, God, because You are God Almighty and nothing is too difficult for You. Lord, I thank You because You have promised us, Lord, to be with us, to guide us, to teach us. So tonight, I bring this request before You. Lord, I pray for each person here tonight and whoever would hear this video if they hear it online, Father, that the words, Lord, would not be mine but would be Yours, and that they would, Lord, take deep root in our heart, that we would know with total confidence, with total assurance, that Your word is true, that You promise to never leave us nor forsake us. You tell us in Your word that the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and they are safe. We thank You, God, for these promises. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So let's all open our Bibles, and they'll put it up on the screen for those who don't. Psalm 91, we're going to look at two verses, and then maybe later on we'll do a couple of the other ones. But the first verse is Psalm 91:1. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him I will trust. Right there. There's so much in those very first two verses. I mean, the whole psalm is a beautiful psalm of protection, of God being with us. And if anyone is dealing with fear tonight, sometimes we don't want to admit that it's fear, so we use beautiful flattery words like concern. I know I'm good for that. Like, I don't want to say I'm afraid or I'm dealing with fear. So I go, I just have some concerns. But you know what? If it's something that it's not settled in me, it's fear. And we need to know that the Word of God says that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of love, power, and sound mind. So if you're dealing with these uncertainties or these concerns, or let's call it what it is, fear, we could give it over to God. He doesn't want us to live in a life of fear. And yes, there are obstacles. Yes, there are things that come our way. But thank God that we can come before Him and say, Lord, here's my concern. Here's these issues. You know them, Lord. You knew them before I even became aware of them. And thank You, God, that You have the answer. And leave it at the cross. But what I would like to do is, as you look at your paper that says soap, which Pastor Peter was so cute and said we have hygiene tonight, a lesson on soap. But the first verse, the first step is the S. And S is for reading the scripture. So we're focusing tonight on Psalm 91:1. So on your paper, you can, you know, you can do it tonight. These are my words, but you can go before the Lord in prayer and do your soap and apply it to yourself. But the first one is simple. It's just rewrite the scripture. So it's, he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. The next step is O. O is for write your observation. What does this verse mean? And remember, I have a little note there on your paper where it says, do not use the language we or us. Make it personal. So actually, I kind of did it wrong because I said the individual that lives in. I should say, I live in the secret place with God, and He and I will live under God's protection. That's a powerful, mighty statement. I will live in the secret place with God, and I will live under God's protection. You could write what the Lord is showing you on your observation. As I was rereading this, I remember looking at it, I go, I could have also wrote about that secret place and wrote down, I observed that there's a secret place that I can live in. I want to live in that secret place, which is actually my next step, A. A is for application. How can I apply what it means to my life? And I wrote down, I want to find God's secret place, and I want to live there with God. And again, when you're sitting, just you and the Holy Spirit, and you open your word, you'll be surprised how you can take this very same verse and find another revelation, a revelation, a message that the Holy Spirit has for you individually. We do this in WOW. We have been now for, this is our second year where we're studying scriptures, and this is what we do. We sit at a table and we open the Bible, you know, depending on what topic. We're doing Woman of the Bible this year. Last year was expecting to see Jesus, and we saw different characters in the Bible. But it was very interesting to have the very same verse, and all the ladies wrote what they observed, how they applied it in their prayer. And it was such an encouraging time to see what the Holy Spirit showed one lady, and how another one got a different revelation, and another, all on the same verse. So this is the word of God. It's alive. It's a promise for each and every one of us. I don't want you to think that this is a technique as far as, this is how I do it and there's only one answer. No, each and every one of you will receive what the Holy Spirit has for you to show you. But it's a help, it's a guide to help you focus, to take out time when you're reading the scriptures and saying, okay, and asking yourself certain questions to focus and not get overwhelmed, but allow the Holy Spirit to show you, what does this mean to me? How can I apply it? And the way I want to apply it is, I want to find God's secret place. I want to live there with God. But P actually was, I received so much revelation even in that prayer, because I went to the scripture because I wanted to see, I want to find, is it a place that God wants me to find? Well, in the Bible it says He does. And so my prayer was actually a prayer of thanksgiving, because I realized, Lord, thank You that You helped me find Your secret place so I can live there with You. In Psalm 34:11, it says, You promise that if I come to You, You will teach me. Thank You, Lord, for teaching me and providing a way for me to abide in You. In Jesus' name, amen. See, to me, this was a prayer of thanksgiving, of confirming what He has already done. He tells us, and there's so many scriptures that you can find about protection. Actually, the back of your paper has tons of scriptures that I put there. They're dealing with find protection and learning more of the Lord, getting guidance, all right? So you can go home and apply this to any of those scriptures and allow the Holy Spirit to teach you and help you find that secret place, because it's here for us. The secret place is not a secret from us. It's a secret for us. And what I mean by that is, remember how the scriptures talk about the mystery of Christ, the mystery of the revelation of who Jesus is, and how the scriptures says that if the enemy knew that God's plan was to send His Son to die on the cross for us, He wouldn't have crucified Him. Because that was the very way that He became defeated. But it was a secret for the enemy, but it's not a secret for us. And this secret place where God wants us to abide is the same way. It's not a secret from us. It's a secret for us. But we need to dig into the word and find that secret place. We need to take the time. It's here. It's in this scripture. We just need to seek it and ask him and thank him that he promises us that he will teach us. He promises that he will help us. So just wanted to, in review about that secret place, because the secret place is a place of protection. And I wanted to go back and look at protection. How did God provide protection in the past, in his word? And the first thing that I thought of was Noah. And I want to bring you to Genesis 6, chapter 14. God provided an ark. And it's interesting. That was the place of protection for Noah. And it says in chapter 6, verse 14, make yourself an ark of gopher wood. Make rooms in the ark and cover it inside and outside with pitch. I want you to remember that. He gave him specific way to create that ark, to build that ark. But Noah had to do several things. And I just want to point to three things to you tonight. One, he had to hear God. He had to be sensitive enough to hear the Lord tell him, build an ark. How many times the Holy Spirit is telling us something? Telling us don't go there. Or go there. And we're too busy. We are so distracted. And then things happen and then you go, something told me not to go there. Or something told me to go there. But it's too late. We were too busy, too distracted. Noah had to hear. He had to hear God's command when he said, make yourself an ark. So are we hearing God? Are we in tune? Next thing he had to do was he had to believe. In spite of the directions. It was build yourself an ark because it's going to rain. Guess what? It never rained. Imagine that whole ordeal of build yourself an ark because it's going to rain and I'm going to flood the earth when it never, I don't even know if he couldn't understand what that meant. But he believed God and he went into action. So he had to act. He had to put it into actions. He had to make the steps and do it. And the word of God says it didn't take one day. It took many, many years. Actually, I'm not sure of the numbers. I should have looked, but I think it took 100 years. But if not, it really doesn't matter the exact numbers, but it wasn't overnight. And many times we hear from God, we believe, we act, but we act for a day. Maybe we act for the week. Maybe we stand on the promise and we do it for a year. Maybe 2 years. Okay, 5 years, now that's kind of getting rough. 10? But I could tell you one thing, no matter how long it takes, when we're abiding in him, he will give you the strength to wait. Those who wait upon the Lord, he will renew their strength. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and then not faint. Okay? So we can wait. If it's God telling us to wait and we really trusting him, we could do it. But let's move on. Let's see another way of protection. The other protection was Moses. Now, many of you know the story of Moses, how his mother had to put him in a basket. And you know, when we see the movie or if we read the story to our children in a children's Bible story, oh, it looks so pretty. I remember looking at it in one of the children books, and the Nile River had beautiful grass and the water was calm, and Moses' mom put him in a nice little beautiful weave basket with a blanket and he looked so good. Guess what? She had to put him in the Nile River. An alligator crocodile infested river. It wasn't that beautiful little, you know, river that, okay, he's going to go lullabying down. She had to trust God with what she loved the most. She also had to act just like Noah did. And she also had to get the directions. She had to hear how to do it, just like Noah. So it's the same steps again, hearing God, believing what he says, acting on it. Now let's go to another protection, the Ark of the Covenant. And that's in, Moses, let me give you the verses, Exodus chapter 2, verse 3. And it says, but when she could no longer hide him, she took an ark of bulrushes for him, dabbed it with asphalt and pitch, put the child in it, and laid it in the reeds of the river bank. All right? And again, I wanted to bring this verse to you so that you could see that it's called an ark, and she had to do something to it. She dabbed it with asphalt and pitch. She had to line it. Just like Noah did. Remember, Noah had to do the ark, and he had to cover it inside and out with pitch. So did she. She had to cover it with this, dabbed it with asphalt and pitch. Now we're going to go to the Ark of the Covenant. And that's in Exodus 25. All right. Exodus chapter 25, verse 10 and 22. All right, the first one talks about God telling us to do an ark, told the Israelites to build an ark of acacia wood. Gave him specific instructions. I believe verse 22 might say about the covering it. And there will be a place where I will meet with you, and I will be on the mercy seat. There God found, it was a place where Israel was gonna meet with God. It was a secret place of protection, of walking with him. And if you've studied the ark, you will know that it was inlaid and covered with gold. It was the same thing, remember that gold, that pitch and the tar? Same thing, it was inlaid. It was wood, but it had a covering. And the ark of the covering had gold covering on it. But what I wanted to point out about the Ark of the Covenant, why was it a place of protection? Because it was a place where Israel would meet with God. And in Joshua chapter 3, verse 17, Israel crossed over the Red Sea, and the Ark was there. The priests had to carry that Ark. And when their foot stepped in the ground, touched the water, the water parted, and Israel crossed over on dry ground. Again, they had to hear God, because when God said, build me an ark, and he gave Moses the details of how to build it, he gave him specific instructions, they obeyed, and they did it. They heard him, and they did it. They also had to believe, and then they had to act. When the Levites had to step into that Jordan River, and we're seeing it in Joshua, verse 17. They stepped out, and they stepped, and the ground was dry. And what's interesting about that is there was a river over it. God parted it. It doesn't say that they walked over mud. And you would think that if it just had water on it, it would be all muddy, and their feet would be soft. No, it was dry ground. This is the miracle that God does. When he protects us, he provides dry, solid ground, regardless of the circumstance. It will be a sure foundation, because Jesus is that foundation. Because that's what I wanted to bring to the next example of protection. We see these three arks. We see the ark of Noah's ark. We see the ark of the basket with Moses, and we see the ark of the covenant. Three arks that God had provided for a place of protection. But he provided a place of protection for you and for me. And that's on Calvary. And it's interesting, because you would think, how on Calvary do you see an ark? But if we go to Galatians, and I'm going to actually skip a little bit. Let me find it. It's Galatians, I believe it's chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3, verse 13. And it says, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. So this is our wood. You had Noah's Ark, which was out of gopher wood. You had Moses' basket, bulrushes, and then you had the Ark of the Covenant of the acacia wood. But guess what? That cross, that wood, it was covered also. It was covered with the blood of Jesus. It was covered with his body, his flesh, with those whippings that he had on his back, ripped his skin, and they laid him on that cross, on that rough wood. It wasn't smooth mahogany, okay? It didn't have a finish. It was a rough wood that caught the flesh of our Savior. But by that wounding of that flesh, we are healed. Those stripes, that blood that drenched that cross is our ark, ladies. It's our arks, guys. It's our place of protection. So when the Lord says, he who dwells in the secret place, that secret place is that mystery of the gospel. That secret place for you and for me is the cross of Jesus. He covered our sins. It says, curse is he who hangs on a tree. He took that curse so that we wouldn't have to bear it. You see, why do we need protection? Because we live in a fallen world. Everything looked good. And when Adam and Eve were created, everything was good. But Adam and Eve sinned. They were deceived by what looked good. And they disobeyed and trusted their circumstances, trusted their eyes, trusted what looked good, and didn't trust God's word. How many times we do that? We trust in what we see. We trust in what we hear, what is told to us, what society tells us, and we don't trust God's word. And that's when we're not in that secret place. But the word of God tells us in Colossians chapter 2, verse 14, having wiped out the handwriting of requirement that was against us, that was against you and against me, that handwriting of our falling. We live in a fallen world, and there was a requirement against us, which was contrary to us. He has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross, having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. All right, what did he do? He took our sins and he put them on that cross and he wiped it out. We are now the righteous, not because of what we do, but because of what he did on Calvary. That is our secret place. That is our protection. But I want to go a little deeper in when we ask him to come into our lives and we ask him to cleanse us and to be our righteousness and we surrender, we say, Father, forgive me. Many of us have done that and have asked him to come into our lives. But some of us have been deceived or have been, I guess, distracted, where we start thinking that his grace is covering everything. And yes, his grace covers our sins. Yes, his grace covers when we fail and fall. But there's a difference when you practice sin and when you fall into sin. Okay? If you're practicing sin, if it's your lifestyle, are you abiding in that secret place? Or are you telling the Lord, I have to lease another apartment because yours is too holy, so I'm gonna be over here for a while? Then how can I expect protection if I'm leasing my abiding somewhere else, somewhere where it's politically correct, or somewhere where it's, 2017, those standards are not quite my standards. Oh, it doesn't really mean that. You know what? Each and every one of us is accountable and we have to go before God. But I'm tired of going around the mountain like the Israelites did for 40 years because of their disobedience. And if we continue to do the same old thing and do it our way, why would we expect different results? We really need to stand and look at ourselves and say, okay, God, help me. Show me. He does. If we want to hear like Noah did, if we want to hear like Moses' mom did, if we want to hear like Moses did, he speaks to us. But do we have ears to hear? Do we have a heart to believe? Do I really want to know? Because many times it's like, oh, that's not for me. That's for the pastor. That's for this. Well, that's for Peter. He's been in church all his life. You know, I don't know the Bible that much. You know what? God is here with us. All it takes is for us to go before him. God, help me. He hears us. He'll answer you. He will. You will turn that TV and you will find a show and he'll be talking to you right there if you take the time. But if you change the channel and put on something else, then that's your choice. But he's here for us. So I'm praying that you would hear what the Spirit has to say tonight. And I want to go to the cross and the truth. The cross and the truth. And Jesus was on that cross. Like I said, that's our redemption. He took our curse upon him. And I want to focus on John chapter 18. And actually, I'm going to focus on one verse. Oh, no, let me do two. It's 36. Okay, actually, I'm going to go to verse 33. Verse 33 says, so Pilate entered his headquarters again and called Jesus and said to him, are you the king of the Jews? In verse 36, Jesus answers him and says, Jesus answered, my kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting that I might not be delivered over to the Jews. But my kingdom is not from this world. So he was saying, hey, you got it wrong. You're asking me, am I the king of the Jews? Because you're thinking about this kingdom. You're thinking about your reign, Roman Empire and everything. He goes, this is not my kingdom. It's not of this earth. If it was, there'd be no question. I would be the king because my servants would have been fighting. Remember Peter on the Garden of Gethsemane? When they came to get Jesus, what did he do? He grabbed that sword and cut the ear of one of the soldiers. But Jesus picked up that ear and put it back and healed that soldier. He said, no, put it down. They didn't understand what was going on. And many times we don't understand. Again, we look at the circumstances. And when protection doesn't come the way we think protection should come, we get discouraged. We get offended. We think God didn't hear us. But we have to be in tune. Remember, hearing his voice, praying, letting the Holy Spirit give you that revelation. Because look what happened in verse 37. Then Pilate said to him, because Jesus tells him, my kingdom is not of this world. He says, so you are a king. And Jesus answers him, you say that I am king. For this purpose I was born, and for this purpose I have come into the world to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice. Again, Jesus is answering him. He's answering him of what kingdom he comes. He's telling him, this is why I came. I came to give you, to witness, to bear witness to the truth. Pilate asks him again. The dialogue continues. And in verse 38 says, Pilate said to him, what is the truth? Guess what? He walked away. The very next verse, and he walked away. So he's asking Jesus, what is the truth? But no time to hear the answer. He just walked away. He wasn't really interested in knowing what Jesus had to say. He was more interested in justifying his action, going and washing his hand and telling the people. He thought, okay, I'll just get these people to release him because they're going to release somebody. And he goes to the crowd, you know, okay, you have a custom and release him. He he was not interested in waiting to hear the answer. Many times we're the same way. We're like Mary and Martha. Martha busy, working, doing things, but Mary sat at Jesus' feet. I pray that each and every one of us tonight will decide, I want to be a Mary. I want to sit at his feet. I want to hear my directions. I want to hear his voice. I want to get that personal revelation of who I am in him and how I have to live my life to please him. But I wanted to bring you, besides Pilate, who says, what is the truth? I wanted to show you that Jesus is the truth. He tells us in his word, I am the truth. I am the truth and the light. No one comes to the Father but by me. But I also wanted to show you, and that's in John 14:6. Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So he is the truth. But Pilate wasn't listening. Pilate didn't wait. I want to bring you to Judges 17:6. This one is about Gideon and Israelites. The Israelites were in fear of the Philistines. They were oppressed. They were working and they were hiding. Why? They obviously were not in that secret place. They weren't in that secret place of the Most High. They weren't abiding under the shadow of the Almighty. They were hiding, running. They were being persecuted. They were being attacked. And Gideon is in a wine press, hiding. And again, just feeling sorry for himself, trying to do his crops in a wine press. But Judges 17:6 gives us a big window to see what was going on in Israel and why they were oppressed. And it says, in those days, there was no king in Israel. Okay? They had judges, but they didn't have king. Everyone did what was right in his own eyes. That is so much a picture of today. Everyone doing what is right in their own eyes. We have all elevated ourselves to being God. We answer to no one but us. I will do it my way. Politically correct. I mean, you name it. Whatever you think about. Think about how everyone does things. What? They do it according to what is right in their own eyes. Instead of studying God's word, going before him and saying, Lord, I want to do it your way. Not yes, to be obedient, but guess what? I find it, it's like, I thank him because his way is 100% guarantee that it is the best way. I know that when I do it his way, I am guaranteed to have success. I am guaranteed to have peace. I am guaranteed to have freedom. Why? Not because I won't have tribulations, because the word of God tells us that in this world we will have tribulations, but be of good cheer. He has overcome. That's why. Yes, obstacles come. Things happen. But when we trust him, when we hold on, and when we wait, just the way Noah did, and he waited, and he acted, and it took years, but he didn't give up. And when we don't give up, and we stand on his word, we get that freedom. We have that peace in spite of the storm. Actually, it was back in August, the end of July. My husband was very sick. He was in the hospital. He's been dealing with issues for years now. But now, since 2014 on, it was like one after the other. And my husband was standing on God's word, believing for a healing. And I remember in July, I had to speak. I believe, I don't know if it was the 13th or somewhere, but the Lord had given me something to share here on a Wednesday night, and it was about being in the eye of the storm and trusting him in the midst of that storm. And I remember speaking that sometimes things don't happen the way we think they're going to happen, and we get all flustered and we don't know what to do because it didn't happen the way we expected the answer to come. But when we trust Him and have faith and believe Him, we still could have that peace in the eye of the storm. Well, when we went home, I didn't share with my husband what I was going to speak. And when he speaks, he doesn't share with me beforehand, because it's like, no, we got to hear straight from God. I don't want an outside influence. And after we speak about it. So when we were going home, he goes, "Did you say all that for me?" And the reason he said that was because he had been in the hospital in July. He was having surgery on August 11th. But he was standing and believing, and he was actually feeling a lot better. And he said to the oncologist, he says, "Do I really need the surgery?" It was for his heart. He goes, "Do I really need it? I'm really feeling so good. I believe I'm healed." And the doctor was going, "Well, look, because you're feeling so good, this is the time to do it." It was a repairing of a part of his heart. He went, "All right." So I said, "Look, we got to use wisdom." Well, Monday, he had a doctor with an appointment with his cardiologist. So we're going to go. Actually, the appointment, I think, was for me. But he wanted to be tested. He didn't want to go into that surgery, I think, that Thursday, without being tested first. He goes, "Look, it's been a while now. I'm feeling good. Maybe things got better." The cardiologist was so sweet. She goes, "Okay, we'll do another echo just to make sure." We did the echo, and it came back. It didn't get worse, but no, it didn't get better. I saw my husband's continence fall, and it was hard. And then that Wednesday, I had to speak about the storm. So when we came home, he said, "Did you do that lesson for me?" I said, "Honey, the Lord had given me that weeks ago. Didn't even know this was going to happen. But, you know, you could apply it. Sometimes we don't get the answers that we expected." My husband had gone to that doctor that Monday expecting her to say, "The echo came back. Your ejection fraction is normal. You're great." And it was 23. It wasn't normal. He needed the surgery. Well, he did have the surgery on August 11th. Thank God. They gave him infusions. They prepared him because he has a lot of complications. So the surgery for someone else would have been in and out. With him, they had to hospitalize him, build up his blood because he's dealing with the MDS. So it's not just the heart, other issues. And he had the surgery, and it went beautiful. The doctors were pleased with the result. Well, I could tell you, we went to the doctor, I believe it was this past Wednesday, a week ago. And the doctor had a cry because the echo came back at normal. His heart is totally normal. He's got two pig valves, so he's still, we call him Papa Pig, but they're working. But the ejection fraction went from 23 to 45. Normal, because all of us have an ejection fraction, how your heart pumps out, and it's from 40 to 75. Nobody has 100%. But if you're in 40 to 75, that's a normal range. His is 45. He's in normal range. We haven't seen the end for normal in a very long time. And we were so happy. But the doctor had to hug him. She had to call the surgeon. She goes, "I'm going to email him, let him know." You see, God answers. He may not answer the way we want him to answer. It wasn't too difficult for God to have healed him. And that first echocardiogram show, "Oh, wow, a miracle. It's 45. Yeah, he could have done that. But sometimes it takes more faith for you to step out and not quit and still believe in spite of the report. God gives doctors wisdom. And I'm not saying that he had to have the surgery, but that's what God chose to allow. The doctor said, "No, you still need it." But we had to step out in faith, believing, "Okay, God, but you're going to go before him. You're going to," we went there, we prayed, we believed, and it's 45. You don't give up. You trust him. And I want to close with the verse that says, a verse that actually has spoken to me so much. And I pray that I didn't give it to them. I don't know if they're going to be able to find it. But it's 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 12. Write it down. Look at it at home. do a soap on this verse because it just spoke volume to me. And it's 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 12. And it says, "For I know whom I believe in, and I am convinced," and it depends on the Bible scripture we have. Some words will say persuaded, and some will say I'm sure. But it says, "I am convinced that he is able to guard what I have entrusted to him until the day of his return." So I don't know what version they have, but it's the same meaning. I'm giving it to you, I believe, from the NIV. But it's, "I know whom I believe in, and I am convinced." Over there it says, "I am not ashamed. I am persuaded. I am sure." What? "That he is able." He is able. What? See, there it says, "I am persuaded that he is able to keep what I've committed unto him until that day," until the day that Jesus returns. So what you have committed to God, what you have prayed and brought it to his to the cross and said, "Lord, take care of this care that I have. Thank you for the salvation. Help me. I am putting this care the way I put it, the way Moses' mom put him in a basket. I am not going to look at the circumstances. I'm not going to look at the Nile River and the crocodiles and the alligators. I am not going to look at what the government says. I'm not going to look at what the terrorists say. I am persuaded," what? "That you are able, that you are faithful. I am persuaded in you that you will keep what I've committed unto you until the day of Jesus Christ." And I pray that that will be our prayer. I pray that we will be built up, that we will leave tonight determined not to be shaken by what's going on around us, not to be shaken by maybe that unexpected telephone call, not to be shaken by our circumstances, but that we will stand on his word. Because that's our standard. We are going to hear what he has to say. And we are persuaded, convinced, that he is faithful to keep what I've committed unto him against that day. Thank you, and God bless you.